paper session. We will start the best young research award. So this is the paper, the Discrete-Logarithm Problem, Preprocessing by Henry Corrigan Gibbs and Dimitri Coben. And Henry, the stage is yours.
So this is joint work with Dima Gokin, who's also a PhD student at Stanford. So the discrete log problem is really one of the foundational problems in modern crypto. We use it to build signature schemes. It underlies the hardness of our key exchange, PDE-based crypto systems, pairing-based crypto systems, and lots and lots of other things. So for the purposes of this talk, I'll define a discrete log problem like this. A discrete log algorithm takes as input a group of prime over n, a distributed group, and a problem that says g of the x, and has to output the discrete log x. So given that discrete log is such an important problem for us, you can ask yourself, why do we believe that this problem is hard? The first reason we believe it's hard is, of course, there's been tons of analysis made of this problem. But another reason is what are called generic group lower bounds. So a generic algorithm is one that works in every group. So a discrete log algorithm that doesn't really care what group it's working in. And what Victor showed is that every such algorithm that works in a group of prime over n and succeeds with good probability has to run in time at least square root of n. So the best generic attack in a 256-bit elliptic curve group, say, takes 2 to the 128 time. And since the best attacks on our standard elliptic curve, say, the elliptic curve groups that we use for key exchange on the internet, the best attacks on these groups are generic attacks, this gives us some confidence in the hardness of discrete log in these groups. Because coming up with a better discrete log algorithm would somehow have to involve coming up with something non-generic that seems very difficult. So this is why generic discrete log lower bounds are so since I'm going to be talking about generic algorithms a lot, I want to define what I mean a little bit more formally. So a generic discrete log algorithm is one that can only make black box use of the group operation. Again, you can think of these as algorithms that work to any group. Formally, we define this with the generic group model, where a group is defined by an injective labeling function sigma that takes an input, sort of an exponent, from 1 to n, and outputs a label, or a bit string, that represents the corresponding group element. So an algorithm in a generic model has access to a group operation oracle that you give it this oracle two bit strings representing two group elements, and it returns to you their product of the group operation is defined by this labeling function. So a generic discrete log algorithm takes its input sigma 1, sigma of 1, and sigma of x that represent g and g of the x. The algorithm makes some queries to this group operation oracle and then has to output the discrete log x. And we'll measure the complexity or the running time of such an algorithm by the number of queries that it makes to this generic group oracle. And as many of you probably know, this has been a really, really useful way to understand the hardness of discrete log type problems in groups, including pairing groups. All sorts of assumptions have seen sort of analysis of this problem. But one reason that sort of is cause for concern about the generic model is that it doesn't account for what we call preprocessing. So the premise of the model is that the adversary doesn't know anything about the structure of the group when it starts executing. And the only way that the adversary can learn about the group G is by talking to this oracle. But in reality, for the groups that we use in real life, there's really only a small number of groups that we use for key exchange on the internet. So a realistic adversary can perform preprocessing relative to one of these groups and potentially use that preprocessing to solve this group log faster later on. And it turns out that the existing generic group lower bounds don't say anything about what happens in the face of these preprocessing attacks. So the model I'm imagining sort of looks like this. A discrete log algorithm with preprocessing works in two phases. In the preprocessing phase, the algorithm A0 takes its input a description of this group G, does some work, and then outputs an advice string. You can think of it as a data structure containing what it knows about the group. Then in a later online phase, the algorithm A1 takes its input a problem instance G of the X, has to output the discrete log x. And in this talk, both of these algorithms are going to be generic. So I'm interested in algorithms that work in every group. When we measure the complexity of such an algorithm, we can look at a bunch of things. We can look at the preprocessing time, so measuring the number of oracle queries in the preprocessing phase. We can look at the size of the advice string that the algorithm outputs. We can look at the online time t of the online algorithm, so how many queries it takes for problem instance. And then we can look at the success probability epsilon taken over the choice the group and over the choice of the challenge. So this is sort of the plan for the rest of the talk. I first want to use an existing preprocessing attack to try to convince you that these attacks are sort of relevant and interesting. This is an attack that achieves a Q group complexity And it works for any group, so it's a generic attack. Then I'll get into our results on preprocessing lower bounds in attacks. So we show that this cube root of n attack is actually optimal for generic algorithms. So you can't do better than that. And furthermore, any such attack has to use a really large amount of preprocessing. So if the online time is cube root of n, the preprocessing time is n to the 2/3. And then finally, I'll talk about a new attack if we have a paper on a DDH-like problem and some related experiments. So the first thing, again, I want to do is show you this pre-existing result. It's a preprocessing attack on a discrete log that works in every group. So the theorem here comes from, sort of appears in many different places, and the result is sort of this form. There's a generic discrete log algorithm with preprocessing. It uses estimates of group-specific advice and online time t, and succeeds with probability epsilon, where the parameters satisfy a trade-off of the form from st squared to the root of epsilon n. And the tilde here is hiding log n factors. So what this means is, plug in s equals t equals cube root of n, so cube root of n bits of advice and cube root of n online time, you get an algorithm that succeeds with a constant probability. And I'm going to skip this algorithm because I think it's sort of a thing that all of us should know, and it's also just sort of surprising if you're used to thinking of discrete log as being a square root time problem. So as a setup to the algorithm, I'll need sort of one slide of material. The one bit of material you need is I'm going to define a pseudo-random walk on the elements of the group. And the pseudo-random walk is going to go from a group element g to the x to g to the x plus alpha, where alpha is picked using a hash function, or you can think of it as a random function. So if we take our walk starting at some group element g to the x, we move to g to the x plus alpha 1, then g to the x plus alpha 1 plus alpha 2, and so on. So we get g to the x plus a bunch of alpha s. And the interesting property of such a walk is that if you know the discrete log of the endpoint of the walk, you can work backwards and compute the discrete log of the starting point. So if we know that we can write the discrete log of the last element as y, we can work backwards and solve for x, the discrete log of the starting point. So having sort of given you this one tool, we can actually put the entire preprocessing algorithm on a single slide. The way the preprocessing algorithm works is in the preprocessing phase, you build cube root of n chains. So you take this walk for cube root of n steps, and you start all these walks at just random root elements. Then you store the discrete log of the endpoints of the walk. So these circles all represent group elements, and in the advice tree you store the discrete logs of the walk's endpoints. So storing these endpoints takes roughly cube root of n bits of advice, right? There's cube root of n discrete logs, each is roughly log n bits, and that's the whole preprocessing phase. Then, in the online phase, you're given a challenge, g to the x, and the online algorithm is trying to find. The way this works is by taking a walk of length roughly cube root of n and hoping that you sort of collide with one of your pre-computed walks. If you do collide with one of these pre-computed walks, you'll end up at one of these pre-computed endpoints, and you'll be able to work backwards and recover the discrete log of the starting point. And it turns out that this takes roughly cube root of n operations. And I'm not going to argue that this succeeds with constant probability, but it's not too hard to see. The catch is that the preprocessing time here is massive, n to the 2/3 time, because we have to build many of these walks, and each walk is quite long. So the fact that the preprocessing time is large is what allows us to circumvent Shoup's lower bound in the online entity set. So just to emphasize what happens here, without preprocessing, we know from Shoup's lower bound that generic discrete log attacks take square root of that time at least. With preprocessing, that drops to cube root of that time. So all of a sudden, if you allow this preprocessing for free, the sort of security of 256-bit elliptic curve groups drops from 128 bits to something like 86 bits. And it turns out that a related preprocessing attack breaks the multiple discrete log problem, and we discussed that in the paper. And there's sort of related attacks that break the Evans-Mont screw cipher, and one from this conference actually breaking the work layer of a hash function. So this sort of cube root of n upper bound is what got us interested in this, wondering whether this is the best discrete log, sort of best discrete log attack for processing that's possible, at least in the generic setting. The reason that's sort of relevant to practice is you could imagine if there were a 10th root of n attack using a 10th root of n in space and time, you would really worry about the security of, say, a 256-bit elliptic curve group, because it would imply that there's sort of a trap door for these elliptic curve groups that would let you compute the discrete log really fast. And if this happened, you could imagine sort of the foundations of what we think of as discrete log crumbling. We might have to revisit the key sizes that we use. practice standards that we use, and so on. So that would be a disaster. So what I'm going to tell you now is that the disaster doesn't happen. In fact, that p-root of n generic discrete log attack is really optimal. And furthermore, the preprocessing time that it uses is also optimal. So you don't have to worry about the situation getting worse. So we proved the following theorem in our paper. So we showed that every generic discrete log algorithm with preprocessing that uses s bits of group-specific advice and online time t succeeds with the probability epsilon has to satisfy a trade-off of this form. Again, st squared is a quarter epsilon n. And it turns out that the attack I just showed proves that this bound is optimal, at least up to the log factors. Log factors, of course, are constant. So this is sort of a robust result in the sense that we know the best you can do for any choice of advice, sort of advice ring size and online time and success probability. And if you're familiar with generic group lower bounds, I should mention that the technique that Victor Schutt used to prove his sort of classic result and many of the other lower bounds that follow from that result sort of crucially rely on the adversary having no information about the group when it starts executing it. And in our setting, the adversary actually has a few bits of information about the group, maybe s bits of information about the group when it starts executing. And so proving running time lower bounds in this setting requires a different set of techniques that I'll describe in a minute. The other thing we proved is a lower bound on preprocessing time as a function of the online time. So the trade-off is like this. If you want to make it concrete, if you want the algorithm to run at online time q-root of n, this implies that the preprocessing time has to be at least 10 to the 2 root time. So there's a very smooth trade-off. The faster you want your online phase to run, the slower your preprocessing phase is going to run. There's no way around that, at least in generic algorithms. So for the bulk of the remainder of the talk, I want to go through how we prove this first theorem here, because that's really the heart of the paper. And before I do that, I want to remind you again of how the generic group model works. So a group here is defined by an injective function sigma that maps exponents to bit strings, or labels. And an algorithm has access to this oracle that implements the group operation relative to this labeling sigma. In a high level, we prove this time-space lower bound using an incompressibility argument, which of course has a really long history in crypto, even longer history in complexity theory. At a high level, we'll use a better-than-possible generic discrete-logarithm preprocessing algorithm to compress this mapping sigma that defines the group. So if we have an algorithm A that is really good at solving discrete log, we can use it to build an encoder or a compression routine that takes as input this mapping sigma and produces a compressed representation of sigma in such a way that we can later decompress it. And we show that any adversary that uses estimates of advice in online time t, such that st squared is little o, gives us an encoding to compress as well. And since a random string or a random sigma is incompressible, this immediately gives us a lower bound on S. So note, we're crucially using the fact that our algorithm works for a random sigma, or for most sigma. This is where we take advantage of the fact that this is a generic algorithm. So I'm going to sketch how this encoder and decoder work. And for the sketch, I'll just assume that the adversary here is deterministic, but it's easy to remove that abstraction. Okay, so I'll sketch how we build an encoder that compresses this random mapping sigma. And again, the high-level idea is we'll use this preprocessing discrete log adversary to compress sigma. So we'll have to somehow construct a compressed representation. The way it works is relatively straightforward. We'll take the preprocessing algorithm and we'll run it on sigma. So the encoder takes the entire function table of sigma as input. And the preprocessing algorithm outputs some advice string. And we'll write that as the compressed representation. Then we'll run the online algorithm, A1, and we'll run it on each group element, which is essentially a bit string in the image of sigma. So say the all zero string here represents some g to the x, it's a discrete log challenge. And A1 will make some oracle queries to the generic group oracle, and then we'll output some of the discrete log of the alternate. What we write into the compressed encoding for the compressed representation is all the responses to A1's oracle. So we'll continue running A1 on all the group elements in lexicographic order, and we'll write the responses to A1 oracle queries into this compressed representation. And after we do this a bunch of times, we'll fix some number of times iterations of running A1. We'll write the rest of sigma, just hard code the unquoried values into the compressed representation. So this is how we compress. Now we have to decompress. So given this compressed representation, I have to convince you that somehow we can recover sigma. And again, the way we do this is not too surprising. We'll just take A1, the online object A1, and the decoder will run it on the first group elements in lexicographic order, which here is the all zero string. As A1 makes queries, we can respond to all of A1's oracle queries by using what's in the compressed representation. And as we do, we'll sort of learn bits of information about segments. So we'll build up a table of the function table of segments we go. So for each query, we'll be able to write one row into this table. The trick is that when A1 outputs a discrete log, we'll get one row in this table for free, because we didn't have to write the discrete log of the all zero string into our compressed representation. A1 gives that to us. So if we continue doing this, we'll be able to build up this table in the way I described, and eventually we'll have all sigma back. So if you believe this, you believe that we'll be able to encode and decode sigma. But I also have to convince you that this is a compressing encoding, so that we use fewer bits than it would take to naively represent sigma. And I'll try to argue that at a high level now. So my claim is that each time the encoder invokes A1, it sort of compresses sigma by one bit relative to the naive encoding of sigma. There's two cases here. So the easy case is if the responses to all of A1's oracle queries are distinct strings. In this case, A1 actually outputs a discrete log for free. We get one row on that table for free, and we compress by something like log n bits relative to the naive encoding. The slightly more difficult case is if the response to an oracle query that A1 makes is the same as a prior response. Basically, we'd have to respond to the same value twice. And if you're not careful, a naive encoding can end up paying twice for the same value of sigma. So you pay twice for the same row on the table, and then there's no savings. So instead, the encoder writes a pointer to the prior query that caused this collision. And if you sort of do some work, you can see that if we run this online algorithm A1 for most n over t squared iterations, we'll be saving, basically this pointer is not going to take too many bits to represent. So each time we invoke A1, whether we're in the easy case or the hard case, we'll save one bit in this size of this representation. So to complete the proof, we show that we'll sort of invoke the fact that a random string is being compressed. So we'll say that if we run A1 on n over t squared instances, the encoder does. Each execution compresses by at least one bit. But then we have to pay for this S bit advice string that we sort of stuck at the top of our compressed representation. So the overhead of this encoding is going to be S minus n over t squared. And this thing has to be bigger than 0, again, because a random string is compressible. And that gives the overall time. So if none of that made sense, just think of using an incompressor earlier, using a better than possible average string to compress a random string. There's some extra sort of technical bits I'm not going to get into that you can check out in the paper about decisional type problems and algorithms that fail often, but I'll just review the paper. So once you study discrete log, the logical next step is to ask about other types of problems in groups, so particularly the DEA problem. We have matching now upper and lower bounds for generic discrete log algorithms with preprocessing, as I just showed. And it turns out the same techniques with not too difficult modifications also gave you upper and lower bounds for CDH that match. But for DDH, we have a gap. So in the dependence of epsilon, the best upper bound we have is solved discrete log, and the best lower bound we have doesn't quite match. So we're not sure if DDH is exactly as hard as discrete log or somewhat easier even with the processing. So we don't know if there's a better attack. So towards understanding this question, we study a related problem that I'll mention on the next slide called the square DDH problem. And we give a new upper bound, a new algorithm on square DDH, the square DDH problem that actually matches our lower bound. And so these are the new results we have. An upper bound for square DDH, and then these three lower bounds for these problems. So just one word about square DDH. The square DDH problem is to distinguish tuples of the form g, g to the x, g to the x squared from random. And it turns out that for generic online-only algorithms, if you're not allowed preprocessing, this is exactly as hard as discrete log. But for generic algorithms with preprocessing, we actually show that it's much easier. And this was surprising to us because usually we think of DDH and discrete log as roughly the same level of difficulty. And here it turns out that once you allow preprocessing, some of these DDH-like problems turn out to be provably easier than the discrete log, at least for generic algorithms. So the last thing I wanted to do is mention a couple of open problems and sort of recent progress in this line of work. So the thing that's been bothering us the most is the tightness of this DDH up to lower bound. Is DDH with preprocessing as hard as discrete log, or as easy as square DDH? Another direction that we think would be pretty cool would be to look at sort of non-generic preprocessing attacks on elliptic curve discrete log. This seems very difficult, but we do have such attacks for DD star. So if we could come up with anything there, that would be pretty surprising. I also want to mention some recent work of Coretti, Lewis, and Guo that gives alternative proofs of similar techniques, or similar ideas in the generic model. And they use the pre-sampling method, which is sort of a complementary set of techniques, pressure arguments that we used here. And they prove the hardness of the one more discrete log problem, knowledge of exponent type assumptions, many things in the ideal cipher model and the random permutation model. So if you're interested in this type of result, you should check out. So I tried to convince you that these preprocessing attacks are surprising and relevant to crypto as we use it on the internet. And I sort of went over our preprocessing lower bounds of attacks, showing that this cube root of engineering discrete log attack is optimal, that the preprocessing time has to be huge, and that there's some surprising new attacks on the digital technology. And with that, I'm happy to take any questions.
Yes, we didn't look at that closely, but it should. There shouldn't